Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J hosts From the Frontlines of the Culture War on Catholic Radio of San Diego. In the second hour of the program, she's interviewing Tom Peters of the American Papist blog. They're discussing his participation in the grassroots-y youth Catholic movement. If you missed the first hour with Dr. Don Hilton, check out the previous podcast.
In my second hour of Catholic Radio of San Diego, I'll be interviewing Mr. Thomas Peters, who is one of the hottest young Catholic bloggers and journalists, citizen journalists writing today. Tom Peters is actually home educated, and he's one of the first generation of home educated Catholics to now be out in the public square doing his thing, turning the world upside down. He's a lot of fun, and you're going to really enjoy him starting right about 7 o'clock. So you'll certainly want to stay tuned in to hear what Mr. Tom Peters has to say about how you can cause trouble with your very own blog and at very low cost. Tom, welcome to the program.
Pleasure to be with you, Dr. Marsh.
Hey, it's great to have you. So Tom Peters is one of the first generation of homeschooled Catholics to make their marks in the public square. He's a graduate of Ave Maria University in Naples, Florida, currently working for the National Organization for Marriage. But in my opinion, he's best known for establishing the American Papist blog. This is a witty blog. I'm talking laugh out loud, funny a lot of the time. It's completely Orthodox Catholic blog. It's funny without being irreverent, hard-hitting, no-nonsense, but still charitable. Tom Peters has initiated numerous writing campaigns among his followers and has called attention to a whole variety of anti-Catholic outrages. So he is kind of a one-man troublemaker for the sake of the faith. So I think it's great, and I'm really delighted, Tom, to have you on Catholic Radio of San Diego to introduce you to our listeners here.
It's good to be back virtually. I was homeschooled in California and actually grew up mostly in San Diego, so I don't get out to San Diego often enough, but this just has to be the next best thing.
Well, that's great. We're so glad you're on the program. So Tom, let's start at the beginning. How did you get the idea to create the American Papist blog? Anybody can get to the American Papist by typing in American Papist, and they end up sort of someplace different right now. But that's beside the point. Tell us how you got the idea for the American Papist blog.
Well, I'll tell you, it didn't start off as anything more than just a little private hobby. I grew up Catholic in a, proudly Catholic home. My father's worked for the church most of his career, and so Catholic topics were just kind of what we talk about around the dinner table. And by the time I got in graduate school, that's kind of when blogs were taking off, and I just kind of, started one like anyone else, and it just kind of gradually grew over time. When I started it, I was in graduate school in theology, and I found it was a nice outlet, on the one hand to be studying Catholic theology, and then on the other hand, through the blog, being able to talk about current issues, because, the church is constantly debating some of the same questions in a new context over and over again. And like you said, I do consider myself a proud member of the John Paul II generation, and I think that my generation of young Catholics have a little bit, not a different take on things, but a fresh take on things. And I think that kind of, is responsible for a lot of the success behind the blog, is that it's not just me. There's tens of thousands of young Catholics who have had the same formative experiences and look at the issues in the same way that I do.
Well, now do you feel like it's your generation, Tom, or do you feel like it's the fact that you were homeschooled or your family's orthodoxy or all of the above? Or I'm interested in this whole big picture of the generation that you're describing for us.
I think it's all of the above. I think what I'm specifically talking about when I talk about a John Paul II Catholic is a young person who either grew up in, a serious Catholic home or came into the faith as a young person and kind of still has that fresh, fervor of a convert. So I'm not talking about my entire, Generation Y, but I'm talking about people who are, young people who are serious about practicing their faith. And, for a lot of us, in this generation, that came through growing up in the faith because of parents who had already, made a very serious commitment to live fully Catholic.
Yes, yes. Now, I can't tell you how many people I've bumped into who found their vocation at World Youth Day in Denver when the Pope came to Denver. I don't know how long ago that was, but there's no question that he has had a huge impact on people of your generation, just through World Youth Day alone.
Absolutely. Yeah, I've been to World Youth Day myself in 2005, and I've had the privilege of being out in Denver. I think that was World Youth Day, I think that was in 1993. But, you know, its effects still linger, and moments like, you know, seminal moments like that, I think, have had a real impact on shaping the identity of the young generation of Catholics that we see today.
Well, and you know, the other thing that's interesting to me, Tom, is that a lot of the sort of wishy-washy Catholics that came about, that sort of, I think of them as 1970s Catholics, kumbaya Catholics, you know, that's sort of worn off, you know. It's whatever good it could have done is done, you know, and something more is really needed. And so that's not really attractive to people anymore, that kind of thing that was popular back then. What is it that's attractive to the people of your generation?
Well, I think for me personally, and for a lot of us, you know, the church's unwavering beacon of moral virtue is just such a refreshing countercultural way to live one's life. And if you give it a shot, it also yields great happiness. You know, when I was an undergraduate in Ave Maria, I had a lot of friends who weren't Catholic, who weren't going to Catholic school, who lived a very different moral life than I did. And not to be judgmental, but, you know, they're making all the choices that the culture tells young people will make them happier, and they're some of the least happy people I've ever met. And so, you know, I think that if you're going to be Catholic, you might as well go all the way. And once you actually live the faith fully, you realize how rewarding it is and how true it is. And I think that, you know, a lot of the education that young people get, I think a lot of the culture feeds, is basically lies and misinformation and a lack of truth about what actually makes us happy. I think that's out of the core.
So even at a school like Ave Maria, there were kids that were not living the faith. I mean, I think of Ave Maria in Naples, Florida, right? I mean, I always think of that as being a very Orthodox place that attracts a lot of Orthodox people. But even there?
Well, I'm an old school Ave Maria graduate. I was a student when I was back in Michigan still, and it moved to Florida after I graduated. I was referring more to the fact that when it was back in Michigan, it was located right next to Ann Arbor.
And oh, mercy. So yeah.
This is more of my friends who weren't necessarily my classmates.
I see. So, yeah, Ann Arbor is like Berkeley of the Midwest sort of thing.
Yeah, they have a constant Occupy Ann Arbor going long before anything happened on Wall Street.
Well said, Tom. So why did you call your blog the American Papist? Is that supposed to be a poke in the eye to somebody, or is that meant to tease somebody, or what's the meaning of that title?
Well, yeah, Papist was actually invented as a derogatory term for Catholics during Reformation times in England. A Papist was, you know, sort of a stubborn Catholic who still followed the Pope and believed in what the Roman Catholic Church teaches. And I just thought, well, why not turn this on its head and say, yes, I'm a Papist. I'm absolutely proud to follow the Pope because he follows Christ and because he, you know, communicates Christ's truth to the world today. So I think the nice thing about the title is that it kind of gives my mission statement for what I'm trying to do, which is to say that the Church has nothing to be ashamed about, at least as long as you're talking about what comes from Christ. And, you know, that's what has made me fall in love with the Church. It's what helps me to, you know, keep that close relationship with Jesus Christ. So I'm a proud Papist, and there's merchandise now too, so it's official.
What did you say? There's merchandise?
Yeah, there's lots of people who have like created, you know, Papist T-shirts, and I'm very happy to see now that there's a whole there's like a half dozen or dozen people who have their own, you know, various blogs using the name Papist. I don't think I really had it first in terms of getting the phrase more popularly used, but I'm happy to have, you know, friendly competition.
Oh, that's great. That's great. So you need American Papist T-shirts to be sold on your blog, on your website, Tom, don't you think?
Yeah, I created a Cafe Press site a little while, you know, a few years ago, but, you know, it's just things have kind of gotten away from me. I don't think I've actually had a chance to update it in a while, but they're out there somewhere.
Yeah, that's great. Now, one of the things that you used to do on the American Papist blog that's not as common nowadays is that you used to have Pope photos and caption of the day or Papist photos of the day. Where did you get the idea to do that, Tom?
Well, photos of the day are just something fun that newspapers run, that websites run. And there's some really wonderful feeds that literally have dozens of new photos, which include the Pope every day. And so I just got into this habit of creating the Papist picture of the day. It's some Pope, or some picture, normally including the Pope. And I just think of a funny caption. And I think that's a helpful thing for people to see, because a lot of what I talk about this sort of, you know, very serious issues like communion and pro-abortion politicians and, you know, religious liberty issues. And it can be kind of, you know, a heavy slog sometimes. And I think it's helpful to remind people that, you know, it's not just, you know, complaints and protests and, you know, disagreements and controversies. There's also an incredible joy, which is at the heart of why I care about all the other things I talk about. So I'm trying to get more in the habit of making that a papist picture of the day and not a papist picture of the month, which is more of what it is now.
Well, I do want to talk with you about some of the campaigns that you have kind of, I don't know if engineered is the right term for it, but you've prompted a lot of people to send a lot of emails and notes and just generally cause a bit of trouble. So I definitely want to talk with you about that. Tonight I have the American Papist himself, Mr. Tom Peters, as my guest. And of course, he's just as Catholic as they get. In fact, on your Facebook wall, Tom Peters, when you're supposed to put down your religious views, I believe at last time I looked, yours said, "Oh, so Catholic it isn't even funny." Is that still your religious persuasion, Tom?
Well, I can say that there aren't too many other people who share my unique brand of faith, but anyway.
Well, yeah, I put something like that on my Facebook page, too, because I thought it was funny. And you know, sometimes we get this image of Catholics being staunch. You know, he's a staunch Catholic. I hate that image. What does it even mean to be a staunch Catholic? I prefer the term faithful or loyal or fervent or joyful. Those are some of the words you've been using. I would rather have that kind of image. And your blog certainly does convey that. But look, one of the things I want to talk with you about is for you to just describe for people how you have used the internet to basically promote the faith in a very low-cost way. I mean, I think of you as kind of a citizen journalist type of a person. So that means a lot of people could do what you're doing, in a sense. And so could you describe, you know, one or two of your favorite kind of campaigns so that people can just kind of see how it works?
Sure. Well, one good example is a couple years ago, a website called Kayak, which is a website where people go to search for the lowest airfare for a vacation. Well, Kayak introduced this advertisement that showed these two young nuns at a convent who were secretly plotting to escape the convent and use Kayak's website to book themselves some airfares down to the Caribbean to break out their bikinis. And I saw the ad, someone sent it to me, and I was like, you know what, I have a lot of young friends who have become religious sisters, and they love it, and they're not looking to escape anytime soon, and they don't think of themselves as repressed. And so the idea I thought of was, well, you know, a lot of people read me and, you know, also don't have much patience for this ad, and so what we did was we all joined Kayak's Facebook page and wrote on Kayak's wall, we don't really appreciate the ad, and we're not going to use Kayak until you take it down and apologize. And within a couple hours, we had completely filled up Kayak's wall with all these people saying, hey, you know, quit picking on the Catholics. I like nuns. And within 24 hours, they had taken down the ad, and one of the vice presidents got in contact with me personally, apologized profusely, and said we didn't mean any disrespect. And as a result of which, I said, okay, well, thank you very much. No harm, no foul. Catholics are happy to use Kayak again. And so that's just one little example where, you know, we weren't mean. We didn't start, you know, hurling insults at them. We just said very respectfully, you know, there's a lot of creative ideas you can use to promote your website besides going after and stereotyping Catholics.
And it took 24 hours for that to happen?
That's right. Well, I mean, from Kayak's point of view, this is kind of like a virtual protest. And so when other people came to Kayak's wall looking for, you know, Webfare discounts, all they found was this controversy going on, and, you know, it's very bad PR when a corporation is called out for singling out a group of people and making fun of them at their expense.
And how many readers did it take to get that kind of response, Tom?
Well, it certainly numbers count, and I have about a couple hundred thousand readers a month. A
couple
what's
hundred
more required
thousand
is intensity.
I'm sorry, wait, stop. You have a couple hundred thousand readers per month. Is that what you said?
Yes, yeah, it fluctuates depending on how active I am and what kind of stories.
Oh, that's amazing. Well, okay, so we have to work to get our numbers up, all of us who are citizen bloggers. But anyway, that's great. So you've got all these readers, but how many of them actually got involved in this campaign?
Here's the point. I'd say only a couple hundred of them did, which is why I say that, you know, numbers are helpful. but it's more about intensity. You know, it's sort of like it's like an army metaphor. You don't need to have a huge army; you just need a small, well-trained one. And I think that's helpful for Catholics to remember that, you know, numbers absolutely matter, but intensity matters more, and especially because intensity matters, participation matters the most.
Yes, and so you were able to mobilize your people. Do you have any sense that the people who read you are Generation Y people like yourself, or do you have people all across the age spectrum, or who are your readers? Do you know?
Anecdotally, you know, I have some resources from Facebook, and occasionally I'll just put up a poll asking, you know, where people are. I would say that it's a majority people in their 20s and 30s. One of the most fascinating stats is that about one-fifth of the readers, from what I can tell, are either seminarians or young priests.
Is that right? Wow, that's amazing, Tom.
Yeah, so that gives you a good sense. I mean, I'm not saying that what I believe is necessarily what all these young men believe, but, you know, a lot of young men who are studying to become the next generation of Catholic priests find me interesting.
That's very interesting because of what you were talking about before, the fervor of the young generation. For a man to become a Catholic priest today, after all that the Church has been through, especially the sex scandals, to become a Catholic priest today, he really got to know what he's getting into. I mean, I think there was a period of time where people joined the priesthood thinking, oh, they're going to relax the rules on celibacy. They're going to relax the rules on birth control. It's all going to be cool. But no one thinks that now, right? And people who join the priesthood have a clear idea that they're engaging in a countercultural vocation.
I think you're absolutely right. I think I had the privilege of studying with seminarians for a couple of years when I was getting a master's in theology. I was just a lay student, but I had a lot of friends, obviously, and we're in the same classes together. And I'd say one of the things that kind of distinguished them is that this is a group of people, a group of Catholics, who I think are the least guilty of complaining about, you know, failings of the Church of any group of people I've ever met. They're just, you know, they look at the problems and the difficulties the Church faces, and they just roll up their sleeves and say, well, you know, this is one of the reasons why God's calling me to be a priest. It's actually a nice parallel to the vocation of marriage, where, you know, if you talk to a young married couple, they're the two people who normally know each other's faults the most and have the most love for that spouse no matter what.
That's an amazing analogy that you just drew. Where did you study that you were in studying with seminarians? Where did you go?
I was at Sacred Heart in Detroit for 2 years. That's where I got my master's. And then I moved out to Washington, D.C. for two more years of theology, and I was studying with the Dominicans here in Washington.
You are now studying with Dominicans?
No, that's what I graduated from the Dominican house in 2009.
I see.
So, and then I got caught into politics like it tends to happen to a lot of people here in D.C.
Yeah. So tell us a bit. Let's start talking about politics. Tell us a little bit about some of the campaigns that you have organized, shall we say, surrounding so-called Catholic politicians or Catholic politicians who do not follow the teachings of the Church. It seems to me you've had something to say to some of those people or about some of those people. Can you tell us about some of those stories?
Sure. You know, there was a very quick example was I'm going to forget what state this was, but there was a pro-abortion Catholic politician who was invited to meet with a bunch of Catholic grade schoolers, and the diocesan paper mentioned that he is a strong supporter of women's reproductive health, which is a euphemism for supporting abortion. So we quickly just asked people to kindly ask the editor what was happening there, and they apologized, and the school went on to disinvite the politician. So that's one example. One of the things I was part of a coalition effort behind was groups of Catholics asking Notre Dame not to invite Barack Obama to give his speech there a few years ago. And through my efforts, we got that over about 400,000-500,000 signatures pretty quickly. Obviously, he still came, but the media was realized that there was an issue here and that Catholics still strongly believe in the dignity of the unborn, and that, you know, we'll at least try to say something about it so it's not just happening in a vacuum.
Well, and you know, that incident, actually, that's a very important incident. I'm glad you brought that up, because the Obama at Notre Dame incident is something that has been divisive within the Catholic community, I think it's safe to say. But more than that, some of the things that he did were it seems to me, quite improper. It seems to me George Weigel talked about this, that he, during his talk, during his speech there at Notre Dame, he made comments to the effect of that you guys who are here listening to me, you guys who didn't go out and protest and stay away from your graduation and protest, you guys are the good Catholics, and those people are the not-so-good Catholics. And it's like, this is really not proper for an American politician to be talking to an American religious group and saying who counts and who's in and who's out. That's not his job. Did you guys have something? It seems like you guys had something to say about that situation too, didn't you?
I'm not remembering the precise details. I was heavily involved with it at the time.
Uh-huh.
You know, it is remarkable to me how, you know, the president and politicians will say that there hasn't been enough dialogue. And that we're somehow refusing to talk about the issues when, you know, they simply refuse to change their minds before we even sit down at the table. So it's sort of a liberal idea of compromise where, you know, you compromise your principles, I don't change my mind, and that's our idea of compromise. So,
right.
You know, I think in those circumstances something different has to happen. You know, on that issue, just to give an example of what I'm trying to do, is that it's very helpful for the spokespeople we have for our side, for instance, for Bishop Darcy, who was the bishop there at the time, to know that there are 500,000 Catholics around the United States who support his position. It's much more difficult for the media and for the president to marginalize someone like Bishop Darcy when he knows and when he can say that he's not alone. He's not some, you know, old geezer who just has this hang-up. You know, there's a broad swath of Catholics who stand right with him and saying that there's a problem and giving an honor to someone who so fundamentally contradicts something that's essential to us as Catholics and as human beings. So what's one of the things I try to remind my readers about in our petitions and our advocacy and our work is that one of the things we do is that we're helping create an entire culture where we protect the people who are sort of in the trenches by showing that we stand with them. And I think that even if the president still comes, there would have been a far greater scandal if he had come and Catholics had just let it happen without even talking about the issues.
Well, you know what? That is a great point. And it's very important that we support the people that we believe in and that we not support the people that we don't believe in and make it clear that there is a difference and that Catholics who follow the Pope and who follow Jesus Christ and his teachings are not just going to sit and be quiet in the pews, that this is something that infuses everything that we think and that we bring it to the public square with all legal means, using all the legal means at our disposal to make it clear that we're here and we're not going anywhere.
I just want to give a quick shout out to all the American Papists who are listening in. I invited them before I came on the show to tune in as well. So I can't see you, but I know they're there.
Outstanding in the rain. That's great, Tom. That's great. And I hope they're all listening online. And while they're online, they can take a look at the whole website of the Catholic Radio of San Diego, see some of the other cool stuff we have in the archives, and maybe head on over to Ruth Institute blog, too, to see our podcast page where we've got all of our programs archived. So that's swell to have a whole new batch of listeners for Catholic Radio of San Diego. We were talking about some of your different campaigns of things that you have done to try to support those who are in keeping with the full teachings of the Catholic faith, and you were giving the example of Bishop Darcy there, who has jurisdiction over Notre Dame, and how it was your goal to support him, to let him know that he was not alone when he stuck his neck out, and so there's a lot that needs to get done in that way. There are a lot of people who are putting their necks on the line, who need to know that there are plenty of people who support us, who support them, and I can't think of any issue where that's more important than the whole issue of marriage and the definition of marriage in particular, whether marriage is going to be the union of any two persons or whether marriage is going to be the union of a man and a woman. And of course, behind that is the whole realm of issues that we deal with at the Ruth Institute, which includes the issue of same-sex marriage and whether there is such a thing as same-sex marriage, along with all of the things that have sort of led us to this point. So I want to draw out from you now a little bit about what you're doing with the National Organization for Marriage. Tell our listeners about that, Tom.
Well, I joined the organization at Maggie Gallagher's invitation in January this year, and I'll be honest that a lot of my time this year has just been caught doing catch-up because it is an incredibly complex issue. You know, the fight over the definition of marriage takes into account politics, law, sociology, media. I mean, you really name it. It's such a fundamental reality, marriages, namely, that everything else in society kind of has tie-ins to it. So
yeah, you bet.
Yeah. So one of my day-to-day duties is assisting with running the National Organization for Marriage blog and Facebook and Twitter, and also sort of being a behind-the-scenes news tracker. I don't even want to admit how much time I spend reading news articles every day. So I kind of help keep our coalition up to date on the news, and also I do some work in Washington, D.C. But a new project that I'm working on launching right now is called Next Gen for Marriage. And the basic reality is that in the same way that I talk about trying to support people who are in the trenches, I want this group to be there to support young people who have taken a strong public stand for marriage. The Ruth Institute does incredible work. And you know, around the country, I think there's more and more young people who are bravely taking a stand saying, you know, I'm under 30 and I deeply believe in traditional marriage. And I want to make sure that people like that have a network of support behind them and realize that they're not alone.
Yes.
You know, so that's kind of a quick snapshot.
Well, that's great. I'm excited about that. And are a lot of your people in the Next Gen kind of project, do they tend to be out of college already? Or are you looking in any particular place to find your next generation people, Tom?
I think a lot of young people obviously kind of, you know, form their core ideas in college
yes.
or make the ideas of their parents their own fully. But also, obviously, we have to have a way of helping young professionals. And I think around the marriage issue, there's sometimes a legitimate concern that if you were outed, so to speak, as someone who believes in traditional marriage, you could perhaps witness your livelihood or, you know, other things be made more difficult for you, which I am absolutely opposed to for a number of reasons. And, you know, anecdotally, my experience has been that for many young people, simply giving them the tools to talk about marriage well unleashes this floodgate in them of desiring to talk about this but not knowing how to talk about it without coming across as, you know, seen as hateful or bigoted or something like that. So I think that we have a situation now where too many young people are being too silenced to talk about their strongly held views in this issue. And so in many ways, just knowing that there's organizations and resources out there, I think, would really help the debate.
Well, you know, we're all about that, too. And one of the things that we produced in the last year or so is something called 77 Non-Religious Reasons to Support Man-Woman Marriage. And we make that available on our website. That's 77 Non-Religious Reasons to Support Man-Woman Marriage. They took that out to Minnesota and gave it out when they were tabling at the Minnesota State Fair. They gave that thing away like candy, you know. I keep getting orders for it, you know, that a lot of people find that helpful. And the idea of that pamphlet is to give people some background and some information and something to say, really. But I'm almost coming to the conclusion, Tom, that the intellectual arguments are not as difficult and as important as the personal arguments. Like you have a friend who's gay, or you have people my age, oh, you have a nephew who's gay, or, you know, what are we going to say around Thanksgiving, you know, when everybody's there and somebody doesn't agree with us? How do we handle the issue? Do you find that to be true as well, Tom, that it's not just the intellectual part of it, but it's how to handle these personal situations too?
I think that's obviously part of it. And I think one of the challenges, you know, for people who do defend marriage is to separate the person from the political agenda. And it's one of the fascinating things I've come across in working with NUM is the numerous examples of people who identify as gay or lesbian who do not want to redefine marriage, who actually see the public good it serves. But, you know, if I think I'm, you know, a voice that people are trying to silence, they are far more, you know, subjected to criticism, et cetera. So I absolutely agree with you about that. But I think that you have to have the intellectual argument in place to be able to comfortably and fruitfully have that personal conversation as well. You have to know what you believe.
Yes. Oh, I totally agree with that. You know, if you don't have the intellectual argument standing behind you, you won't have the confidence to open your mouth in the first place. You know,
right.
that's what I find with people. But all I'm saying is that even if you have all that, you know, there's this other element, this other dimension that I don't want somebody to be mad at me. And add to that the part of, gosh, I don't want to lose my job, which is a real possibility. And you've really got kind of a perfect storm for people feeling silenced, like they just don't want to open their mouths at all. But can you tell us a few of the tales that you've come across recently of people who have been threatened with losing their livelihood or who have come into these kind of professional problems? It seems to me I've seen quite a few of those on the NUM blog lately.
Oh, it's extraordinary how many stories there are. And actually, one of NAM's projects is called the Marriage Anti-Defamation Alliance, which you can find at marriageada.org. And that tells the stories of numerous people. Really take your pick. One person in particular would be Frank Turek, who many years ago wrote a book defending traditional marriage. And he's also a hugely successful motivational speaker. Actually, he talks about encouraging diversity in the workplace, ironically enough. And I say that it's ironic because he was asked by two separate corporations, by Cisco and later by Bank of America, who basically terminated his contracts once someone Googled his name and found out that, horror of horrors, he'd written a book explaining why marriage should be between a man and a woman. So it's actually, we can say happily that we've achieved some victory there. The most recent thing I heard was that both those corporations stepped back and apologized for that and are looking to renew their contracts with him. But again, who knows if that ever would have happened unless there was an organization around to tell his story. And one of the things I've noticed as well that's unfortunate is that largely we can't expect the media to tell the stories of people on our side of the issue. And luckily, with social media and YouTube and Facebook and all these things, we can tell our own stories now, but we just have to realize that it's up to us to tell the stories if people aren't coming at our door knocking and asking for it.
Yes, but there certainly are plenty of stories that can be told and need to be told. And I have the feeling that we need to get the message out. It's almost like we have a window of time here, a window of opportunity, where there are enough bad things happening where if people know these things are happening, they're going to say, wait a second, we've gone way too far down this path. I don't think we need to empower this group of people any further. They've got enough power. But we need to kind of consolidate that and help people to see that while there's still time. I wonder if you could bring us up to date a little bit on some of the things that are happening around the country politically that your organization's involved with. I just want to mention that next week on our program, we'll have Maggie Gallagher on our show for one of the hours of Catholic Radio of San Diego on Monday night. And I'll be talking with Maggie Gallagher, who is the foundress of the National Organization for Marriage. And she and I are going to be talking about this issue of what do you say around the Thanksgiving turkey table there when you've got people in your family who disagree with you on this issue. How do you have a civil conversation? How do you get through Thanksgiving? How can you navigate some of the choppy waters around the personal aspect of talking about the same-sex marriage debate or the debate over the definition of marriage? But tonight I want to wrap up our conversation with Mr. Tom Peters by having him tell us just a little bit, Tom, if you would, about some of the kind of political hotspots around the country. What are some of the things that are going on in terms of electoral campaigns that the National Organization for Marriage is involved in?
Oh, sure. I love talking about this because, you know, we rarely get to talk about our victories as much as we're asked to talk about an occasional defeat. We actually have had an extraordinary year. We defeated efforts in Rhode Island and Maryland to legalize gay marriage, actually largely through the African-American and Hispanic churches for those victories. We moved Indiana closer to having a vote on marriage in 2014 to put in their state constitution that marriage is between one man and one woman. In Minnesota, we successfully put the same constitutional marriage question on the ballot, and the people of that state will vote next November in the presidential elections. And we did the same thing in North Carolina, and they'll be voting next spring about the definition of marriage. At the same time, gay marriage activists in California gave up their efforts to try to repeal Prop 8 at the ballot box because they correctly surmised, once again, that the majority of Californians still believe in traditional marriage. And just this week, actually, the largest gay marriage organization in Oregon officially gave up their efforts to ask the voters to weigh in on the question because they realized that they, too, would lose. So, you know, the only exception to a whole string of victories this year was, sadly, New York, where four Republican senators took some very bad political advice, and we currently have a $2 million campaign to kick them out of office and replace them with people who trust the people and will protect our good and common sense marriage laws. So again, there's probably been about 15,000 stories about our defeat in New York, and maybe 1/1,000 of those stories about, well, maybe not quite, but far fewer stories about victories for traditional marriage. So, and the bottom line is every time the American people have been allowed to vote on this, they always vote to uphold our marriage tradition. So, not only is the fight not over, it's actually going our way. And I think in the same way that you said that the intellectual argument isn't, you know, kind of what it's the heart of this, I agree with you. I think that people right now are kind of mostly deciding the marriage issue more and more, and it's now an effort to silence those who disagree with those who want to redefine marriage. And I think there's still more of us than more of them, and for good reasons. It's because the truth that's deep in the human heart. So if you're curious to keep up with this, the National Organization for Marriage's blog talks about these issues daily, and we try to keep our supporters very up to date, as you can tell.
Well, you know, I find the newsletter that Brian sends out periodically to be very helpful and very uplifting, you know, and I think the point that you made that I really want to emphasize to all of our listeners is that a part of the strategy of the Let's Redefine Marriage crowd, part of their strategy is to make us give up and go home in defeat, you know, and they have this kind of storyline that the march of history is all about redefining marriage and being more inclusive and having less rules about who can marry who and what marriage means. And gosh, by the time it's all over, marriage just will be a government registry of friendships, and there won't be anything left of marriage. And won't that be swell? You know, but they have this march of history narrative, which is designed to make us give up and say, "Oh gosh, we're losing. I guess we just should all go home and." Oh, man, I'm so embarrassed that I think men and women should be married, and oh, gosh. And that's their ammunition. So as long as we stay on the playing field, we keep winning. And so it's very important that people absorb the fact that the storyline is part of the armory and of the weapon. It's one of the weapons in the armory is to make you discouraged so that you'll give up the fight. So in New York especially, I feel like, Tom, we didn't lose an argument there. There was this incredible New York Times story about that. We didn't lose because we didn't have good enough arguments. We lost because we didn't have enough money to buy the politicians. And the New York Times was like shamelessly saying, well, there were a couple of rich Republicans, one of whom has a gay son, who decided that this is what they want to do. And they spread money around and they bought some politicians and they didn't call for a vote until they had enough politicians lined up. And that's the end of it. And I was like, wait a minute, this is corruption. This is wrong. You know, you're not supposed to brag about this kind of stuff. What is going on here? They don't have any arguments. They're losing on the argument. That's my feeling. What do you think?
Well, I mean, I completely agree that the march of history goes both ways, and it's up to us to decide which way it goes. You know, speaking personally, my parents were very active in the pro-life movement in the late 70s, and at the time they were told by all their, you know, all their progressive friends that, you know, by the time 2000 rolls around, there won't be any more pro-lifers. You know, they all have died out, and abortion will be the law of the land, and they'll just be completely settled, and it'll be over, and the march of history will continue. Well, they were wrong, and now there's, you know, more young people believe in are pro-life and are pro-abortion, and that's why. And I always tell young people who are, you know, trying to get involved in the marriage fight and have hope, why? Because our parents didn't give up, and that's why we're here. And it, frankly, looking at the laws of this country, looking at the culture, we have more weapons, we have more tools at our disposal, we have more common people who still, you know, have this great core truth on marriage than we did on the issue of life at the time. So there's no excuse in the world not to be fully engaged. History is up to us to write, and I think that young people involved in this debate particularly understand that, because we have the rest of our lives to write this history.
Well, and you've got the rest of your life to live with the consequences if we don't get it right, you know. And one of the things when I'm talking to young people through the Ruth Institute, Tom, I can't tell you how many times I've had the experience of people, you know, coming up to me and thanking me for what I've been saying, because I talk about the whole marriage issue. I talk about how divorce is harmful to children, and everybody said, well, gosh, divorce will be fine as long as the parents are happy, the kids will be fine. Well, today's young people know that this is a complete lie. You know, the whole of the sexual revolution has been about setting aside the interests of children in order to promote the interests of adults. That's what it's all been about. And so as that unfolds, it becomes more obvious how that's true. It takes a while. People can't put the pieces together necessarily straight away. But Tom, I can't tell you how many times I've had people come up to me, young people come up to me practically in tears and say to me, I've never heard anybody say that divorce is harmful to children. Thank you so much, Dr. Morse, for saying that, because nobody talks about it. So, if we can help young people to kind of put two and two together, I think there are a lot of people who really are quite receptive to the message, because young people want to get married and stay married, and they can kind of see that taking away all of the boundaries on what marriage is and what it means is not going to further anybody's interests in the end. You know, adults can love one another and sing kumbaya without any structure, but raising kids, no, that's another whole deal. And if we redefine marriage, we're going to end up redefining parenthood at the process. And, you know, you start pointing that out to people and they're going, wait a second, there's more going on here than you guys just being big meanies, you know. there's some real substance going on here. So that's I was so delighted when I learned that Maggie had hired you, because I just think so highly of the work that you do. So it's great to be on the same team. As I suppose you know, the Ruth Institute is part of the NOM, the National Organization for Marriage Family. We do a lot of the C3 work. We do the college outreach work and so on and so forth. So we're, you know, you're in Washington, we're out here in San Diego, but we're all getting it done, you know, of trying to put together the big pro-marriage coalition. Can you say just a little bit about what's going on in Iowa? Because I think that's kind of an interesting story as that's all unfolding.
Yes, we got within only a couple thousand votes just last Tuesday for getting the Iowa Senate back into a balance where we could introduce legislation to allow the people of Iowa to finally vote to overturn gay marriage there. Previous to this, we had successfully kicked out three judges who had imposed gay marriage on the state, and basically all this election means is we'll have to wait until next November to elect politicians who strongly support the right of people to vote on something as fundamental as marriage. So, you know, it's been extraordinary. And I, you know, through meeting, we actually met a few years ago at a conference in Michigan. And so I've had that same experience of having the first time someone actually, you know, laid out all the social science research and explained why sort of my gut feeling was correct and actually plays out in culture, et cetera. But to get back to Iowa, you know, I believe in complete and unconditional victory for marriage, and so every state that's imposed gay marriage, you know, we are fully committed to overturning and repealing it. And I think the silver lining to the debate and the question about what is marriage is that it's forcing many of us to understand and appreciate what a good marriage is when we've previously taken it for granted. I know that's true for myself personally, and I think that's one way that we can turn the lemons and the lemonade, is that it's forced our entire country and our entire society to really sit down and think through, why is marriage the way it is, and why is that a good thing? And I think, you know, in that sense, because we're defending something that's true, only good things come when you try to defend the truth.
Well, Tom, that's a great place to wrap up our program here on Catholic Radio of San Diego. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. You've been listening to me interview Mr. Tom Peters of the National Organization for Marriage. See you next week, and keep the faith, San Diego.
You've just been listening to Dr. J from the front lines of the culture war on Catholic Radio of San Diego, where she and Tom Peters discuss the youth Catholic movement. Check out CatholicRadioofSanDiego.com or look us up on Facebook for more information on the show. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.